Quiet now, everybody. Quiet, listen to me. We're going to start a show.
For another episode of the Ink and Paint Club podcast. My name is JD.
And I'm Kyle.
Yeah. Alright, so I actually am feeling pretty good about this episode today, Kyle. How are you feeling today?
I'm feeling terrible.
Oh, no.
What else is new?
I can't tell if this is a shtick or not. You're trying to force in.
Sometimes.
Kyle, you didn't get my corny joke for this week.
Did I?
I ask you how you're feeling. We're going to talk about Inside Out later. Never mind. Fuck it. Moving on. God damn it.
We should have planned that out a little bit.
My entire point of my corny jokes is that you're supposed to catch them. I'm not supposed to. It's not funny if I tell you ahead of time.
Anyways.
All right.
Got some news.
Well, hold on. All right. So if you're new to this. The Ink and Paint Club podcast is a weekly show Kyle and I do where we talk about what's going on in animation, the news, and all that stuff. Yes, we're going to talk about some news here in a few minutes. I just want to give a little heads up to anyone listening to this. We are going to be, the second half of this show is going to be a review for the new movie Inside Out, and it will be laden with spoilers, so if that is something you want to avoid... this is your fair warning now. I'll probably put another warning on right before we talk about it, but just heads up on that.
That's a pretty good call. I didn't even think of that.
Yeah. That annoys me when people don't like... Like, I'm not a person who really cares about spoilers most of the time, but, like, I like to know ahead of time, like, you are going to be spoiled, just giving a fair warning. I think it's nice to do.
I kind of like spoilers, on the other hand, because it gives me something to look forward to.
Right, yeah, I can understand that. Most of the time, I just don't really care, but... for those of you who do care, spoilers. Anyway, so before we get to that, let's go through some news. There isn't a whole lot of news, quote-unquote, this week, but we got a bunch of trailers that came out. That was pretty exciting.
Slightly.
Depending on your point of view... let's go backwards, because the way I have this list set up, they actually kind of get less and less exciting. So, the first trailer, it's this movie called Secret Life of Pets. Kyle, did you even know about this movie before this trailer came out?
Nope.
Nope. Me either. So, this is... God, what do they call it? It's the same studio that does Despicable Me. I think it's like Illuminate. No, Blue Sky does...
Like, or it's Illuminate.
Yeah, it's Illumination, right. In this trailer, it just shows a bunch of pets, like, doing what they do after their owners leave or whatever. It didn't really show anything. I actually had to go look up the plot to this movie, and I guess what it is, it's like, this dog gets a new dog into his apartment, and they're gonna be, like, fighting and, like, not getting along, but then I guess there's this rabbit, I guess, who's trying to build an army of, like, abandoned pets that they're gonna take over the human world or something? Eh.
That sounds so bad.
I don't know.
It sounds like cats and dogs.
Kinda, actually, yeah, I should say that.
Yeah.
It's weird. But my only... I'm glad that Illumination is doing something different. Like, they're getting out of the Despicable Me universe, which... I don't know about you, Kyle, but I just am sick of seeing Minions.
I have a friend, and he's always constantly saying, he's gonna know exactly what I'm talking about. But he's just like, I don't get the hate. I don't understand it. And it's like, I can see where he's coming from and stuff, but I just think people are tired of seeing Minions.
It's everywhere. That's what I am. That's how I am. It's just like, I'm oversaturated. It's everywhere I see. There's parodies of it. It's just always in my face, and I'm just like, after years of it, I'm tired of it.
You get the mom and dad posts from Facebook,
mm-hmm.
And it's like, Monday, isn't it?
Exactly.
And it's just a little annoying.
I don't know. But anyway, about this trailer.
Yeah. As far as the trailer, when I saw it, I'm like, does this movie even have a plot? It just seems like
yeah.
It would be a bunch of skits of, like, stupid.
Well, yeah, it's a teaser, so it's like here's just the basic look of the movie. Basically, it's not telling a whole lot about the details. But my only there's two things that I am trying to remain hopeful for this movie is one that Illumination's getting out of Despicable Me. It's something original, so it's not like the Lorax or whatever they did. And the second is Louis C.K. is one of the main characters, and I'd like to think he has enough integrity to not attach him to something that he doesn't believe in. I like watching his stand-up. I have not been keeping up with his TV show, sadly, but we'll see. So, the next trailer came out, Kung Fu Panda 3.
There you go, you got it in one.
It's a tongue twister. So, Kyle, what did you think about this trailer?
I mean, the whole thing was funny. I've never watched a Kung Fu Panda movie, to be honest.
Yeah.
I'm not, like, excited for the Nickelodeon cartoon. I'm not, like, getting ready to watch it on Saturday. Yeah. Just kind of don't care. And then, like, third movie's coming out. It's like, really?
I think...
The whole exchange with his dad was pretty funny.
I don't know. Least. I thought it was so stupid. Like, in the trailer, this big other panda shows up to Jack Black's panda, this guy whose name is escaping me. He shows up to the restaurant and he's like, I lost my son. And Jack Black's like, I lost my father. And they're like, okay, see ya. And everyone in the restaurant just, like, does a facepalm. And I was like, I'm with those people. Like, Jesus, no one's this dumb.
That's a little precocious, isn't it?
I know. But I think you should watch the first two Kung Fu Pandas. It, like, from the outside, it looks really stupid. But, like, the choreography is actually really well done. They, like, do real justice to, like, the different kinds of Kung Fu that they're representing and the characters. And it's actually kind of funny. I don't know, like, what the general consensus is, but I actually like the second one a lot better than the first one. I don't know. I think
people like the second one better.
The first one was good. Set up the world and all that stuff. But the second one just, I think, had a better story.
That was with the peacock, wasn't it?
Yeah. I don't know. It just had a cool thing, and, the peacock hat was interwoven with Jack Black's character's backstory, and that's going to lead into this movie. So, I like the first two. I'm kind of excited to see a third one. So. And Rebel Wilson's gonna be in it, because everybody loves her.
Yeah. Typecast as a fat animal.
It's true. Like, it's weird because I only like Rebel Wilson when she's in Pitch Perfect. I don't really, like, have an opinion on her in any other movie she's been in.
Damn, I don't think I've ever seen a movie she was in.
Oh, well, that's alright. She's still in that phase of, like, getting, like, everyone's starting to know who she is. So, give her another year or two, and she'll be in every movie, and then she'll fade out like everybody else.
Sounds about right.
I'm not trying to say that I hate Rebel Wilson, I actually think she's very funny, but, alright, so moving on, Hotel Transylvania 2 is coming out.
I watched the first one. And I wasn't too crazy about the jokes and everything, but, like, it was animated nicely.
Yeah.
Gendy
Tartakovsky, Kyle.
Yeah, that guy. Whoever he said. Oh. He did a good job with it.
Yeah. Yeah, that
was just so disheartening seeing the original art for it, and then what it came to be.
Yeah. Yeah, oh yeah, you really liked it, because it wasn't a lot, like, more creepier.
It was, like, kinda anime-influenced, but not, like, weeaboo shit. I thought it looked cool, but, I mean, design-wise, it looks great. It's just another... I mean, when you boil it down, it's just another Adam Sandler hanging out with his friends movie, except this time it's animated.
I guess so. I was real hesitant to watch the first one, because, like, it just seemed like a really dumb idea. It just seemed... I don't know. But then it's all like, oh, Gendy directed this, and, like, I saw some of the animation for it, and I'm like, this is, like, really wobbly, and everyone's real stretchy, and it was really animated, like, really well, like you said, so I gave it a chance. It's like, yeah, this is pretty good, but, I don't know if this is bothering you. Dracula's daughter and her, like, husband or whatever, they have a kid, but not even the husband looks visibly older.
Yeah, pretty much.
Like, he was, like, 18 in the last movie, and I think this one's, like, a couple years in the future, but he still looks 18.
It's enough for the kid to be walking and talking.
Yeah, like, I think he's like, 3 or 4, I think they said. Yeah, like, they've had a kid for a couple of years, but the parents don't look... Like, I get that the vampire girl doesn't look any older, because she's basically immortal, but the redhead kid doesn't even look any older, and it kind of bugs me.
Man, I did not like his character at all. I didn't like Andy Samberg. It just, so bad.
Yeah, well, you know. The rest... Hello. Oh, well. Okay, so I've been wanting to talk about this, of the movie I'm actually really excited for. We finally got a full trailer for the Peanuts movie.
I liked it a lot.
Yeah.
It's, like, so amazingly, like, on model to his art. And, like, Charlie Brown's daydreaming, where it's all...
Yeah, that was really cool in the trailer. It's like, yeah, his when it pops up, it looks like the comic art is just moving. And it's like, yeah, geez, that's...
It's absolutely how he drew it. Absolutely animated. It's so cool that way.
And what I love about this so far, from what I've done research, is that they are making sure you know up front that this is Charles Schulz. Like, this is, you know, these are his characters. We want to respect this as much as we possibly can. I mean, I think his son and his grandson actually wrote, and I think they wrote the movie.
Oh, that's kind of cool.
Yeah. I was reading that yesterday, and I was like, that's really cool. And I like that on the title, it actually says by Schulz on it, and I think it's really cool that they are trying to basically pay tribute to Charles Schulz with this, and I think, I don't know.
And I'm like, I need to see it again myself, but is it kind of like Paper Mario in a sense, where they're kind of like, they're almost 2D in a sense, but they're like three-dimensional?
It's...
When they move, it's very, they kind of snap to a pose, and then they snap to another, or something like that.
Kind of.
Certain parts like that.
Yeah, I think it's... My guess is how they did it is they actually have models for whatever position they're in, whether you're looking at it from the front or the side. But yeah, that's something I thought was really cool, that it is coming into the new age. It's in 3D like every other movie, but they're still trying to make it look two-dimensional, and it's weird, because I think the style that they're going for is actually working really well. Because it's trying to imitate the comic art, but still be in 3D.
And then, like, I'm actually pretty excited for it. Not really a big Peanuts fan. It's actually super depressing if you read the comics.
No, like, my girlfriend hates Peanuts so much, and it's only because the kids are assholes.
Yeah.
Like, she hates how mean the kids are, and I'm like, you're a teacher, you know how mean kids are.
Yeah, pretty much.
No, but I think it's so... I think it's okay that they're mean, because, like, that's how you... Every kid is a jerk when they're little, and just how kids are, and I think it's just actually kind of... I think it's a realistic portrayal. Speaking of kids, I thought this was interesting. There are no celebrity voices in this, because all the kids are actually voiced by actual kids.
Thank God on that.
Because I was so worried that, like, okay, this is going to be a big-budget animation film. They're going to find some way to shoehorn a celebrity. And I was going over the voice cast, and I was like, I don't know any of these people, because they're just kids.
It's like, it's good and bad, because if they decide to do a sequel and they're a bit older, not going to work.
I don't think they'd ever do an older Charlie Brown. I think it would lose all of its charm if they were any older.
Well, I mean, like, the children's voices are going to change out, like...
Well, I think it's like they do with the direct-to-video ones. They'll just find another kid that sounds remotely the same. You're never going to run out of kids.
Yeah. Kids are a natural resource.
Exactly. They'll keep coming.
My only problem with the trailer, and, I mean, everybody thought this too, it's just they're terrible... choice in the soundtrack. And I'm worried if it's going to actually be in the movie.
Don't think so, only because more often than not, trailers are not put together by the studio. They actually outsource it to a company that makes trailers. So they basically give them a rough cut of the movie and they'll piece it together. Which is why there's a lot of trailers out there that you'll get like, way too many spoilers for the movie. Like, you basically know the entire the plot from the movie from,
like,
the trailer.
Like Cinderella. It was the whole fucking movie.
Exactly. I mean, we already know the story of Cinderella. It's not like you're doing anything groundbreaking there, but yeah, basically, it's like you're gonna see the movie, you're gonna see the Cliff Notes version of the movie start to end in the entire trailer, and I've seen so many directors and studios get mad because it's like you basically just spoiled the big secret of the movie with the trailer, but because they've got no control over that, at least Peanuts, like, there isn't really much of a plot as far as I can tell so far, so it's not like they can spoil much, but I think they've shown just enough to get everybody excited.
Yeah, I mean, you know, he wants a fresh start. It's gonna be the little redhead girl,
mm-hmm.
and he's gonna try to bone it, so...
He's like 10! Jesus.
Like 10-year-olds know anything about love. Come on, now.
Oh, God. Alright.
Anyways.
Alright, you got any other words on these trailers, Kyle?
Nah.
Alright. Alright, so we're going to move into these two new shows are coming out to Cartoon Network and Nickelodeon, respectively, in July. I guess the first one here, this one's on Nickelodeon, Pig, Goat, Banana, Cricket. Yeah. I didn't think about this till just today. I think it was almost a year ago now, Jesus. I went to the Ottawa Animation Festival up in Canada, and one of the panels that I went to was actually a preview for this show. So they had the creators David Cooper and Johnny Ryan, which, Kyle, if I remember right, you're a fan of Johnny Ryan?
I like Johnny Ryan's stuff. He did Prison Pit, and he's got, like, I don't know, he's very vulgar. He's very edgy for the sake of edgy, he's actually funny, though.
I've never heard of any of his stuff, but I'll take your word for it. But, this is coming out July 18th on Nickelodeon. When I look...
Sorry. I dig the style. Style's very different.
Yeah.
From what I've seen.
When I was looking this up, apparently it was a comic in Nickelodeon Magazine about 10 years ago.
Oh, yeah. That's right.
Yeah, like, when I looked at it, it's like, this looks oddly familiar, and it's like, yeah, this is kind of how Nick Magazine used to look a long time ago. But the basic conceit of this show is that, like, in every 22-minute episode, they're going to give, like, little short vignettes to each of the four characters that is somehow all going to tie back together at the very end of the episode.
That's pretty interesting.
Yeah, but we saw, when I was at the festival, we saw a couple, the animation wasn't finished yet, so it was a lot of animatic stuff. But yeah, it's a real bizarre show. I'm not entirely sure how I feel about it yet.
It looks fun. A lot of people are questioning why they changed it, because it was originally Mantis, and why it went from Mantis to Cricket.
Mm-hmm.
We're wondering why. Well, from what I understand, from what I read, they said that since Kung Fu Panda is still being aired on Nickelodeon,
yeah,
and they have a character basically named Mantis,
right,
the Kung Fu style, that they changed it. But mm-hmm. It's like, they didn't even really change his model, did they? He still pretty much looks like a mantis.
Yeah, but kids are dumb. They won't know what a cricket or a mantis actually looks like.
True. What's interesting about it, too, is I guess they did a demo reel or something.
Mm-hmm.
Like, they paid someone to do the, I don't know, pilot, whatever it was.
Yeah.
It was very, very small, like, 3-minute thing. And I think that was kind of cool, because that's how they pitched it, I guess, was that little 3-minute cartoon they produced.
Yeah. Huh. I didn't know that, but that's cool. Yeah, there was, like, I forget who the producer was on this, because I thought he said he worked on Animaniacs or something. But yeah, it's just a very odd show.
It looks fun.
Oh, Paul Rugg, that's who it is.
Oh, shit, that's Freakazoid, dude.
Yeah, Paul Rugg is one of the... Oh, wait, no, Paul Rugg is one of the voice actors. Who am I thinking about? I don't know. He was there, and I can't remember what his name is. But yeah, he, or maybe he's not even working on it anymore. I don't know.
It was something.
Anyway, it's just a bizarre concept, and I mean, the voice cast is all right. I mean, you got Paul Rugg, Freakazoid, that's cool. You got Biff from Back to the Future as the banana.
That's awesome.
Which I thought was hilarious. But, yeah, I don't know. Like I said, the last thing I saw of it was an unfinished animatic, so maybe it's changed a lot in the last year. So.
I saw like a little thing with like chocolate bubbles or something.
Yeah, I think it was like a short clip they released the other day.
It seems okay.
Yeah.
It's a step forward in the right direction, I think.
I'm hoping so, because honestly, other than Ninja Turtles, I can't think of the last thing I watched on Nickelodeon.
Yeah, I mean, I'm not. Even though it's done by, like, the same dude as Bob's Burgers and all that, I really cannot stand Sanjay and Craig.
Yeah, Sanjay and Craig didn't look interesting. I've heard good things about Harvey Beaks, but I haven't got a chance to...
Harvey Beaks is pretty comfy.
Yeah, it looks like it's just it's a feel-good show. You can sit down and just... It's just very chill. But...
So, next.
Next. So over on Cartoon Network, we're getting a new show called We Bear Bears. Like, we come bearing bears. Jesus. This show, this one's coming out July 27th on Cartoon Network. It was created by this guy named Daniel Chong, who I guess used to work for both Pixar and Illumination. But basically, the elevator pitch of this show is these three bears, a grizzly bear, a panda bear, and a polar bear, are just trying to integrate into human society.
It was like based on a stupid little webcomic.
Yeah, I guess. But
like a duck, 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 goose thing.
Yeah,
I remember.
Or something. I was really confused by the concept in general. It's just like, okay, how are you gonna? The art style looks very simplistic, and it just like I can see this as like a short or something, but I don't see this being a full series. But then they still released a clip of the show, and I'm like, I still don't see how you're going to drag this out into a full show. It looks like the joke's going to wear thin real fast.
Pretty much. And then it's like, to me, I don't think it's like all that original concept either. Like, I've never seen someone trying to integrate into human society, like
Right. Peter
Zim or, you know, just other stuff.
And sheep in the big city?
Yeah, like that. It's not all that new.
Yeah.
I'm too excited about it from the clip I saw.
I don't know. But we'll see. Like with the Pig Goat show, I'll give it. I like to give any show a fair shake. I'll give it a couple episodes. If I don't like it, I'll stop watching it. But
yeah, same here.
I'm not like vehemently against this show. I'm just like, eh.
I usually am until it went to
I know you just like instantly hate something. Just like fire coming out your mouth, hate, and then you're like, eh, it's okay.
Yeah, pretty much.
Jesus. Alright, well, I don't have any more news. Like I said, the news was kind of bare this week. Bears. These are the jokes, folks. So, Kyle, unless you have any other news stories for us today.
Nah, I think we're good on the news front. I think we spent way too much time on the news, actually.
I don't know.
Let's go to sports.
No!
the weather.
That'll be different for everybody. This is worldwide.
Oh, yeah.
The forecast in your neck of the woods. Get some Al Roker in here.
It's gonna be hot, because it's summer.
God, oh god. Kyle, like, I don't know about you, because you live in California land, but here in Ohio, it's driving me crazy. Because it rains for like 20 minutes, about 5 times a day, and in between that, it's like 80 degrees and 100% humidity, so it's awful outside.
Over here, it's, like, hot enough to not breathe.
Yeah, I get that.
And it's, like, hell on earth without the demons.
Yeah, all your grass dries up and it's a desert.
don't have water.
Oh, yeah, you're in a drought.
Yeah.
Remember all those signs I sent you? It was like, look at all this water we have. We're just throwing it away.
It hurts my feelings.
I know. Well, you try living next to, like, 4 Great Lakes right above your state. We can just go get it, even though I think Lake Erie is, like, radioactive at this point.
I hope so. I want superpowers.
I think you'll just get cancer from Lake Erie.
I hope it's super cancer, though.
That's one of the few Family Guy jokes I remember, it's like Adam West rolls around and is like, what are you trying to do? You have like stage 4 cancer. And he's like, I was trying to gain superpowers. It's like, what made you think that would work?
That was when it was good.
Oh, I love crazy Adam West. Okay, we're getting off topic. All right. So that's it for the news and our rambly ramblings about the weather in the world. But so we'll be back in a second. Again, heads up, the next segment is going to be a very spoilery review of Inside Out. So if you don't want to be spoiled, you can just turn the podcast off now. If you want to stay around, if you've seen the movie or you just don't care about spoilers, stay tuned and you'll hear me and Kyle babble on about Pixar. Yay! Kyle, what'd you do with your break?
I sat here. Yeah.
Wow. Good job.
If you were waiting for a joke, there it just wasn't going to come.
I just should stop expecting things from you. So anyway, in lieu of an actual topic like we have the last couple episodes, we're actually going to do a review of the new Pixar movie Inside Out.
Our first of many reviews.
Yeah! Yeah, that's the thing we want to try to do on the show periodically, is like, if a new movie comes out, Kyle and I can just throw our 2 cents out there, and you can listen to that.
We can bring up spoilers and
right.
plot holes that
One,
we found.
For like the third or fourth time, there will be spoilers here, so this is your last warning.
Yes.
Okay,
and a new thing that we want to try out is actually to say if we like the movie or not.
God!
Review.
Jesus Christ. Anyway, I think before we get into the actual review of the movie, I'd like to talk about the short film that was in front of this. Sorry. It's late here and I am out of my mind. Anyway, so, like with every Pixar movie, there's a short in front of it, and this one was called Lava. It's basically this... The story is this volcano with a face on it is lonely and just wants love, and you just... he sings this ukulele song through the whole thing about how he's lonely and wants love, and then a lady volcano shows up, and they love each other. Best synopsis ever.
The year
story. No, this is actually weird because again I went to a festival last year, and we actually got to see this. I actually saw this short like 4 times because I'm sorry. I'm not like trying to brag. I'm just trying to relate this to my own life experiences. But yeah, we went to I forget what it was in front of, but we went to some screening and they said, oh yeah, we're gonna show the new Pixar short in front of this. And so that was cool, and it was actually funny because the director was there, and he actually played the song in person on a ukulele, and it was actually kind of cool.
That sounds pretty cool.
I actually have a lithograph poster with his signature on it in a tube somewhere.
Was he, like, insanely overweight, like, is?
God, no! No, yeah, that made me sad. Brother It is dead. He's been dead for a while, actually.
Yeah,
long time.
He was cool.
Yeah, he was cool. I liked him. But, yeah, Kyle, what'd you think of Lava?
It was okay. I wasn't, like, all that into it.
You didn't get the feels?
No, it was very basic. You got a character that just sits there. Like, nothing going on.
I mean, I'll give it...
Adventure.
I'll give it to him. They gave emotion to a mountain.
They did.
So, congrats on that. No, but, yeah, it was... cool. You know, I liked it. I thought the song, it was catchy.
Yeah, it was nice.
Yeah. Yeah, it was actually kind of interesting. I wish I could remember, because, sorry, I hate to keep bringing this up. When I was at the festival, one of the days, they actually had a panel about this short, And they did a lot of the behind-the-scenes stuff, so we saw, like, the animatic and a lot of the storyboards. And he said he pitched, like, two other ideas to John Lasseter, and this just happened to be the one that he picked. Because I guess, like, if you work at Pixar, occasionally John Lasseter will just come around and ask you if you have ideas for shorts, and you have to pitch it to him. But you have to pitch three ideas. I'm pretty sure that's what he said. You have to pitch three ideas, because that way, if one of your ideas sucks, they can just move on to the next one. But
moving on.
Yeah. Yeah.
I dug it. I was reading online what people thought of it, and they're like, all I could think of, I don't know if you've seen it or not, or if anybody else has seen it, but they were talking about, it was an old water commercial, and it was called Volvic Water, and it's a volcano and a dinosaur.
Oh, I never saw that commercial, but I saw it using, like, memes and stuff.
Yeah, that's that's all I could fucking think about.
Oh God, now that you say that, it seems so obvious.
And it's Matt Berry, like, doing the voice of the volcano.
Oh God.
Tyrannosaurus Rex Allen.
Oh, no. Anyway, so, yeah, Lava was cool. It was a cute short. I kind of forget a lot of the Pixar shorts. They all kind of start to run together, but, you know, it was good. I don't know if I'd put it high at the list. Jerry's Game is still number one for me.
I like Day and Night a lot.
Oh, yeah, I remember that. Was that the one that was in front of Toy Story 3?
I think so.
Yeah, that was cool because I liked how it was in 2D.
Now, would you say that you lava'd it?
Oh my God. Jesus. No. No, because I'm the one who's supposed to be making corny jokes. That's my thing.
It's not even that big of a corny joke.
I know.
Because they said it in the...
Yeah, it's the whole conceit of the song. Yes, lava, good. Good Pixar, good. All right.
Give it a C+.
We're giving letter grades.
I don't know.
Yeah, for these reviews, I don't, at least for now, I don't think we have, like, a scale, because I think scales are stupid.
A scale of 1 to 1,000.
Sure. You can give it whatever scale you want, I'm just going to say if I liked it or not. Alright, anyway, let's get into what the meat of this show is. So this weekend, Pixar, after like a year and a half hiatus, came out with a new movie, Inside Out. So... I assume if you've seen this, or don't, whatever. Basically, Inside Out is about this... I think she says she's 11. This 11-year-old girl.
It's this little girl. She moves from Milwaukee to San Francisco. And then she's got Marge Simpson on her head with the blue minion. They go on an adventure because they get lost. And then Super Meat Boy, the Great Gazoo, and Doofenshmirtz try to take care of everything going on while they're away. And that's basically the movie.
I guess. I still understand why you keep referring to these characters at that, but that's essentially what Kyle says. But to be a little more specific, so inside the head of this girl, Riley, she's literally piloted by her five emotions. You got Amy Poehler as Joy, who is basically playing Leslie Note from Parks and Rec. You got Phyllis Smith from The Office, who I've never watched The Office, so I have no idea what her catalog is. You got Mindy Kaling as Disgust. You got Bill Hader as Fear. And in the most typecast role of ever, you got Lewis Black as Anger. Like, it's so perfect that he is Anger, and it's weird because there's actually some points in the movie, because when I watch Lewis Black stand up, when he gets really, like, squint-faced angry about something, he'll, like, do this one-finger point at the audience, and they actually get that into the character a couple times.
I never noticed that.
Though. Yeah, it's just like, the part where he's saying he ruins pizza, and he's like, you ruined pizza, and he's just like, gritting his teeth and pointing out at the real world, and he's just like, that's exactly how Lewis Black does his stand-up.
Fucking Hawaiians ruin pizza.
Yeah.
Volcanoes in love and shit.
Yeah, it's like the Hawaiians ruin pizza. So did, yeah, San Francisco, apparently.
I will have to agree with that.
Yeah, but This was an interesting movie. I'll admit, I wasn't too excited about this when I heard it, because it just seemed like it could go wrong in so many ways.
I liked it. It wasn't too bad. I mean, I'd hate to use, like, Cars 2 or, like, Brave as the worst Pixar movies, but I wouldn't say so. I didn't like
it at all. That's fair. I wouldn't say Brave is bad. It was just not what I expected. Cars 2 is bad. Cars 2 is hands down the worst Pixar movie.
And it's not even their fault. It's Disney.
No, it was. Yeah, it was Disney saying we need more merchandise. Make another movie, and they're like, okay.
That's why we're getting a Toy Story 4.
Yeah. So in this movie, she moved the Riley girl moves to San Francisco from Minnesota.
Yeah,
she moves from Minnesota, she moves to San Francisco, this big city. She's like, it's a lot of trying, trying to deal with change as a kid, and you can, like, her parents are, their stuff hasn't shown up to the house, they're basically sleeping on the floor the first couple days, her dad has to keep leaving to attend to whatever business. I don't think they ever said, like, what he does for a living. Investments or something.
I want to say they did, but I forgot.
Yeah, I remember, like, all of his phone calls is like, oh, the investors aren't supposed to show up or something, but yeah, I don't remember what he did exactly. Doesn't matter. So you kind of just see gradually her emotions in her head reacting to all of this change, and you can see how it, like, just starts to wear on this kid. Okay, I guess we should talk about the whole concept of the inside the head world.
It's definitely not a new thing. I mean, we've seen it before in cartoons, like the joke going around about SpongeBob.
Yeah.
And then, I mean, Disney did that short too. It was what was it again? Reason and...
Oh, the Reason and Emotion. Yeah. You told me to watch that, and I watched it earlier today. It was funny, because, like, you told me ahead of time, okay, this is one of Disney's old propaganda films, and I'm like, okay, that's fine. But it's like, it was showing how people are driven by reason and emotion, and then it just took a whole left turn. It's like, all right, we're talking about Hitler now. It's like, just out of nowhere, it's like, well, that's not how Hitler runs things, and I'm like, where'd that come from?
I love how they drew him. He's just so evil.
That's perfect. Out of all of Disney shorts, I thought that was probably the best portrayal of Hitler, because the rest of him, he's just like this goofy-looking dude, but in this one, he's like, he's really fluid, and I don't know.
Well, the idea about that short is that it's two instead of five. It's just, it's piloting someone. And that's where I thought they kind of got the idea, because Cars had another Disney short that it was kind of based on, and then I read the director was like, oh, well, I actually based it on my daughter's and all this, so...
Yeah, I can see that.
I figure it was slightly influenced, but maybe not.
Yeah, so... All these five emotions that live in her head, they basically have this whole command center that they have this big keyboard that basically can influence the girl depending on the situation. And every time something happens, it generates a new memory, and this little orb comes in, and it glows whatever color responds to whatever emotion it elicited. And I guess this is like something, like, when I thought about it, I couldn't think of my own personal ones, but they have this concept of, like, core memories. It's like, these are the defining moments in your life that make you who you are.
Yeah, I'm like, I was thinking about that too. I'm like, I can't think of shit that influenced.
Yeah, and maybe it's something you have to see from the outside, but yeah, when you try to think about it your own, it's like, yeah. But I can't think...
I don't think a person has that, like, specific memories, remember, all the time, and it's like, I don't know, like, for you to get your personality that way from those, that kind of I didn't really like that.
Yeah, I mean, I think it made sense for the plot of the movie, because basically what happens is that Joy is, like, the head. She's not, like, the boss of all the emotions, but she's basically playing Leslie Note from Parks and Rec, so she basically just takes control of everything.
She was a control freak.
Yeah!
Shit.
We'll get into that. But yeah, so she's wanting to make sure Riley is happy at all times. She'll occasionally let fear, disgust, or anger pop in when it's needed. But and the more the movie goes on, I just felt so bad for her. But they just do not know what to do with sadness.
Yeah.
They just keep shoving her into this corner. Like, there's literally a point in the beginning of the movie where, like, okay, first day of school, we need you to stand in this circle. We're drawing a chalk circle. Stand in this circle. Don't leave the circle.
Contain all the sadness in this circle.
Yeah, it is just, like, it's so passive-aggressive because you can tell that Joy doesn't really... She doesn't hate sadness. It's just, like, they're polar opposites, so it's, like, she just doesn't comprehend her purpose, and she's like, it's not till later in the movie you figure out, like, what sadness has to do with all this, and that, you know, she's really crucial to everything. But yeah, it's like the entire movie is just Joy, like, trying to work around sadness. And the, like, the meat of the movie is launched off when sadness, like, she keeps, like, every time they tell her to do something, they'll turn right around and she's messing with stuff. So it's like, if she touches one of the memories, it becomes sad. It becomes a sad memory, which is...
Starts, like, bleeding blue.
Right.
Starts bleeding into the yellow.
Right. And, which is weird because none of the other emotions had that power. I think it's weird that sadness has that power, but no one else does.
I don't know, like, it felt like certain emotions go together, like, fear and disgust were kind of, like, together in a sense.
God, have you seen the fan art of they're shipping all the emotions with each other and on DeviantArt? And...
Nah, I'm good on that.
Yeah, don't go, kids, don't go looking for that. It's not gross, it's just, like, why does this need to be?
I don't need that autistic stuff. No, it was weird, but, like, she's the main control freak in there. You notice everything within a day's work is mostly just happy memories. Her core memories are just happy, and these are, like, 7 shelves full of, like, the yellow orbs, and maybe there's a red one, maybe there's a purple one.
Yeah.
Like, she didn't... She was a control freak.
I mean, she even brags about it, like, in the first, like, 5 minutes. She's like, look at all these memories. You'll notice that they're mostly happy. Not to brag or anything. Just like, Jesus.
Yeah.
So, the movie kind of gets launched off when, I think it's, like, on Riley's first day of school, and they're trying to prepare, you know, making sure she's dressed right, making, like, trying to think of everything that could go wrong and trying to avoid it. But, you know, sadness is, you know, wacky hijinks getting into stuff. She starts playing around with the core memories for, I don't know, and they start freaking out. And what basically how these memories work is...
it's like a projector, almost?
Well, like how they get filtered in when they happen, and there's, like, there's this big wall on the side that they stay in, and then at the end of the day, they all kind of get flushed into this tube and sent out... into the rest of the brain, where it becomes basically subconscious memory.
It's put on, like, a library bookshelf.
Yeah, it's basically this giant library, which I think it was really cool how they did it. It's, like, all the shelves really squiggly, so it looks like the wrinkles in your brain.
Yeah.
So that was cool. Sadness starts playing around with the core memories, and Joy starts freaking out, and they accidentally get sucked up into the tube and shot down into the subconscious memory, which is basically leaving fear, disgust, and anger at the wheel.
It was because that sadness had actually made, like, a core memory that was blue.
Yeah.
Freaked the fuck out.
Yeah, it's like, you tainted it, you can't change it back. And she just, Joy flips her shit.
And then, like, all the bullshit that they had her doing actually came in handy. Like, all the manuals she read, she had to do her way around.
Yeah, because, like, as soon as they get to the subconscious memory, it's like, God, okay, we need to get back, but the only way through is we gotta go through this maze, basically. And she's like, I have no idea where to go. And Sadness is like, well, I read all the manuals, so I know what where to go. And she's like, all right, let's go. Yeah, so it's like they start going on this adventure. They keep bumping into different parts of the brain. They run into these... They're cleaners, I guess. They sort through memory, and it's where you learn about the dump. Basically, this big black chasm where wherever your memories have started to fade or whatever, it just dumps it. It's basically the recycle bin on your computer. It's just you don't need them anymore.
It's just where you forget your stuff.
Yeah, it's
which is weird because like when you forget stuff, you kind of recall it,
mm-hmm.
and then you're like, oh, I remember now. So it's kind of weird that it was like. This stuff is deleted forever. You're never gonna remember it. I remember stuff from my childhood, like weird stuff.
I think a lot of it's just like real small, insignificant things. Like your brain just can't handle every tiny little detail, so it's basically just throwing out those little specifics,
yeah,
or something like that. But then they run into Riley's imaginary friend from when she was a child.
Yeah,
this guy.
I liked him a lot. It was Bing Bong.
Yeah, Bing Bong. Voiced by Richard Kind. Kyle, I don't know if you know who Richard Kind is.
I do. Okay. After I looked him up, it's the guy who is like Hopper's cohort.
Yeah, yeah.
Bugs Life.
Yeah, you've heard Richard Kind. I know him from he was on Scrubs for a couple episodes, and I think he was on Spin City back in the day, but that's where I know him from.
Oh yeah, that's
but
right.
As soon as you hear him, you'll know who Richard Kind is. Anyway, but yeah, they run into this guy. He apparently knows his way through the whole mess of the brain, so we join Sadness, team up with him, and it actually leads to my favorite part of the movie, where they, like, okay, they, I think it's when they're trying to go to the Imagination Land. There's like, I know a shortcut, and they go through this door. A little says, danger, stay out. And it's like this tunnel they have to go through. There's a big door on it. You're not supposed to open it if they go through it anyway, because Bing Bong's like, I know a shortcut, let's go. But then, like, these workers on the outside, while they're in the tunnel, it's like, oh, wait, why is this door open? All right, well, turn the switch on, we'll flush anything that's in there.
They were looking for something. They were, like, looking for an abstract thought that was on the loose.
Yeah.
And it was, like, loneliness, I think, was the abstract thought.
Or something like that. But it's my favorite part of the movie, because basically what happens is once they flip the switch, Joy, Bing Bong, and Sadness start transforming, because they're trying to be broken, because it's trying to visualize abstract thought. And so Sadness, every time they start transforming into more simplistic shapes, and every time they transform, Sadness will, like, tell you what stage of abstract thought they're being broken down into.
Yeah.
So it's like, at first they become, like, these Picasso-esque, pointy figures, and then become, like, blobs and, like, two-dimensional lines as they keep trying to walk through the tunnel to get to the other end. But just, like, the way that the art style just keeps changing every couple seconds to visualize abstract thought is like, Jesus Christ, this is hilarious.
And then they just change back.
Yeah, once you get out. But it was cool, because I figured, like, it was a nice touch, because I figured, like, as soon as they exit the door, they'd be normal again. But no, like, they take a few seconds once they get back out into the main part of the brain to, like, you see them, like, gradually transforming back into their normal selves.
They reverse the stages, basically.
Yeah, and I thought that was really cool. And I think that's something cool that this movie does, is it tells you, it's showing you as well as telling you basic brain functions, and like almost giving you like a psychology lecture in a sense.
Yeah, that's true.
So they keep going through all these different worlds. You start to get to know...
As they're breaking down because, like...
Right.
Personality's changing from...
Yeah. While Joy and Sadness are, like, going off on this venture, disgust, fear, and anger are still up in the control room, and they are just not handling the situation well at all. They're just like, okay, what would Joy do? And it's like, they're not Joy. Like, I think Disgust at one point is like, they're like, why didn't you do that? And it's like, I'm not Joy. I don't know what she would do. But, like, they cause a scene at school where Ellie just starts breaking down and crying. But, yeah, it's like, as the adventure goes on, Riley's got these, like, they call them islands, that are basically, like, they're core parts of her personality. So I think, like, she's got a friendship island, she's got a family island, she's got a hockey, yeah, honesty, I think hockey, which I don't know how that's a personality, that's more of a hobby, but, yeah. And then there was, Goofball Island, and just, like, as joy and sadness make their way across, you just see each island just crumble and fall apart and fall into the void as it's just lost. And it's interesting because as each island falls and Riley's personality starts to break apart, it'll zoom back out to Riley herself, and you can just see this kid's just like, she just seems so defeated, and she's just holding up and just becoming this withdrawn, unemotional person. But I thought the obvious gag that really kind of bugged me, and it's not like a huge nit, it's just more of a nitpick, but it's the train of thought. It's a literal train. It just seemed like the obvious joke.
Well, they're on the train, and I think they have to catch it, basically. And they go to, like, Imagination Land.
Right.
Or, it was the studios. They go to a studio, and it's, like, where her dreams are made. And since Joy's not there, Fear's doing, the studio.
Okay.
And they need to go on the train because it's, like, shut down when she's sleeping.
Right.
So they have to wake her up, and that's why they go to the studio. They need to, like, make a nightmare almost to wake her up.
Yeah, and I think that was, that's where you started seeing what sadness can really do, is because, because throughout the whole movie, Joy is just like, she is the literal embodiment of joy. She is like, wants to make everything happen through happy, and because the train of thought doesn't run while Riley's asleep, they go to the dream studio, and they're like, okay, we're gonna happy her awake, and sadness is just like, we've woken her up with a nightmare before, why don't we do that? And Joy's just, nah, we'll make her so excited she awakes, and it's just, it was interesting how the dream starts fucking up, and eventually Joy sees that, okay, she's starting to get freaked out in her dreams, it's starting to wake her up, we need more of that.
Now, the one thing I liked about this was, when they were doing the dream sequences, it was first person.
Mm-hmm.
They were like, the camera's her, let's act like this. And they had a filter, because it's like little, it's almost like minion-looking blob. And they put like a filter in it so they can actually look like the people she's thinking of.
Yeah, I thought that was a cool touch.
I was talking about this last night, but like, when, usually if I'm thinking of a memory, or if I'm thinking of my dreams and stuff, it's usually in first person.
Mm-hmm.
And I liked how they did this, but then it was like, I can kind of understand why they do it, but then again, it's whatever. I know it's a cartoon, and it's not true to life. It always kind of bugged me when they do, like, say a memory or something, and the character is in their own memory as themselves. Remember yourself in your own memory. You see it how you experience
right.
It. First person. So when she has these memories and she's thinking of herself, and I'm like, that's kind of dumb. So when they did the dream and it was in first person, I'm like, okay, that's cool, because they're addressing her like, oh, well, your teeth are falling out now, and and now you don't have your pants and all this stuff in this dream. I thought it was funny because
mm-hmm.
Yeah, they're using the camera like it was her head.
Yeah,
I thought that was kind of cool.
Yeah, it was cool. I will say, my own personal dreams, when it is a memory, I see it in first person, but, like, I had a dream last night where it was a completely made-up scenario, but I saw it all from third person. Like, I could see myself outside of it. But, yeah, I agree with you. I think that was a really cool way of illustrating that.
I guess it's just different with everybody.
Yeah.
Like, my girlfriend was saying that she sees it from the third person,
mm-hmm.
this kind of stuff. I've never experienced that, so I don't know.
Yeah. But, yeah, that was cool. What I did not like about this sequence particularly, and it's kind of like with the train of thought, it was like the obvious, it was the low-hanging fruit. They made Riley afraid of a clown, and that's how they woke her up, is they had to go down. So I guess there's like this part. It's like the subconscious memory. I kept calling the library subconscious memory, but there's actually, it's a literal dungeon where they just put, or Bing Bong refers to it as the troublemakers. They lock you in a dungeon.
It's like just broccoli.
Yeah.
Vacuums that she's apparently afraid of.
Yeah.
She's a dog.
Yeah, but yeah, basically all your, yeah, that was weird. It's like, why are you afraid of your grandma's vacuum? That's, I don't know. But in the back of the dungeon is there's this giant clown monster that I guess is some interpretation of a clown from a birthday a long time ago. But I just feel like that's such an obvious fear. I feel like they could have come up with something with a little more original that would
like
seem...
a spider?
Yeah, or something. I just feel like every time someone wants to illustrate that they are afraid of something from their past, it's always a clown. Like, yeah, clowns are creepy, but, like, I don't... Like, I'm not... I personally am not afraid of them.
I know some people that are, like it's a true fear, but, I was really hoping, because she... They wake him up by pushing on its nose after they save Bing Bong.
Mm-hmm.
And I was really hoping, like, oh, man, I hope this is like a Jurassic Park thing. Running from this animal.
Yeah.
He's, like, slowly stomping towards him. I was really hoping for it, and it did, like, gradually build up where this clown is chasing them.
Yeah.
Like, oh, it's a birthday party over here.
Yeah.
So fun. And I do want to say, too, that it was, like, the darkest shit I've ever seen from Disney or Pixar was they had dressed up like a dog. It was because they wanted Riley to wake up excited and all this, so they dressed up as a dog, like the two-man horse suit,
mm-hmm.
and they end up separating, and since the dream filter's on where it sees it for what it is, this dog is literally cut in half.
Yeah, and you see all the...
Like a giant piece of bone.
Yeah, you see all the meat inside the dog, and like, oh god, that's kind of creepy.
And then since Joy and Sadness are fighting to get together, it uh-huh. shows the dog is fighting its butt. And it's like, super scary. And that was like the point they were trying to get Fear
yeah.
to wake her up.
Yeah, because I thought that was just really funny is... I guess, like, every night they kind of, like, have a shift where it's like, all right, you gotta be the one who stays up all night monitoring the dreams and stuff, and because Joy is gone, because she usually does it, Fear is stuck doing it, and he's basically sitting there like, all right, what's on tonight? He's got a remote and everything, and he's just sitting back drinking coffee.
And what I liked about it, too, was he wasn't, like, cliched, like, just scaredy cat.
Because no.
Like, oh yeah, I've never seen this before. And he was like super sarcastic.
Yeah.
Doing. I like that.
That was cool. Yeah. That's another thing. I like that they all the emotions were their designated emotions, but it wasn't like that is the only thing that defines them. They do have, like, anger can be happy, and disgust can, you know, think something's okay, and Fear is not always, he's not like in a constant panic attack, he's, you know, he's trying to keep her safe, as they say.
That's one thing that I actually wanted to see explored, they never did, and I know it's dumb, but I was just hoping for it to happen. I wanted to see the emotions inside the emotions. I was just thinking of, like, well, you have Fear, and yeah, he's being happy, or, you know, you have anger, and he's kind of showing smug happiness and stuff, and I kind of wanted to see it look inside their head, but then again...
They're made of particles. They're made of particles. They don't have a head.
Yeah, they're just particles, and which I like, too. If you look in the animation, and they're moving around, the particles come off their head and just kind of linger, and then just...
Yeah. I honestly think that's why Pixar took the... like, as long as they did between films, is just, like, to develop the look of this movie, because you're right, the emotions all, if you look at them, like, when they do the close-up shots, they look fuzzy, and if you look, yeah, if you're, like you're saying, when you look closer, these little particles just start drifting off them, and
yeah.
It's, like, it's, they're made out of light, they're basically light constructs made out of particles, and I don't know, that was a really cool effect for them. Anyway, where were we in the plot?
Well, so after they wake her up, they keep moving on, and they get on the train, but the train gets derailed. But that was the funny thing, was when they were on the train, it was like fact and opinion, and they like... They messed up. It was in two different boxes, and they're like, "Oh my god, they look the same." And he's like, "Oh, don't worry, this happens all the time." And they were mixing fact with opinion.
Yeah,
and that was a cute little joke.
Oh god, but, I love that.
The train derails, and they're kind of stuck again.
Oh, sorry. was that about when when they start falling into the pit, or was that later?
Wait, it was a little bit later from that.
Yeah. Wait, I have the entire plot synopsis right here. I should just read it. Sorry, I saw this a couple days ago. You saw it, like, yesterday.
I know.
I saw this on Friday, so... but, yeah, basically, they're still trying to get back. All the islands are really starting to fall apart, and...
Oh, that's when fear and anger and disgust...
Oh, right.
...want to move, like, they... They put an idea in her head.
Yeah.
Run away.
Yeah, yeah, basically, like, you kind of see Riley from the inside, because, like, earlier in the film, her mom comes to her and is like, look, I understand, like, this whole move is stressful, your dad is really under a lot of pressure from work, and it just, like, it means a lot to me and your dad that you're still this happy kid and you're so amazing, and it would just mean a lot to us if you just, like, kept a smile. And you could just see how much that, like, just stresses this kid the hell out.
Yeah.
But it's like, as the movie goes on, and you got the fear, disgust, and anger at the wheel, and they just can't handle everything by themselves. And it gets to a point where anger is just like, look, we don't have any core memories anymore, and this kid is breaking down. Minnesota's where we made all the core memories. Let's just go back there. So, and I thought it was, like, this is when the cliche joke that I didn't think was funny is, like, they've got a whole, like, shelves of light bulbs, and what they could do is screw it into their console, and that will push an idea into Riley's head, and, like you said, they basically, like, okay, we're just gonna run away, we're gonna hop a bus, we're gonna go back to Minnesota, we're gonna just basically start over.
And it was, like, long-term, that doesn't work at all, like, at all. Where are you going to live? What are you going to do?
Yeah,
are you going to stay with?
And I think that was, you know, that was cool because, like, it just shows that she's not thinking about what the consequences are. She's literally being driven by emotion at that point. She's, like, she's stressed, she's tired, she's just miserable, and you could just see her, how she's just, like, losing all feeling emotionally, and she just, like, I want to go back home.
And then it was like, the problem was, they couldn't get the idea after they wanted.
It goes on, and they're like, oh shit, maybe this isn't such a good idea. And they can't get the light bulb out, so they can't stop her anymore. But, basically, back where, like, joy and sadness are, and this is where, like, I stopped... Like, I never stopped liking Joy as a character, but this is, like, where you really see how she really doesn't get it, and she's kind of self-centered.
Extremely self-centered.
Right.
Holy shit.
Yeah, but basically what it is that back up in the headquarters, they can call certain memories if they need to, and they're basically fed through these tubes, and they kind of run across this broken tube, and Joy's like, we need to get back now, and...
It's just like, peace out, sadness, and just bounces, and it's like, what the hell's that about? She just left her.
Yeah, she's just like, it's like, look, Riley needs to be happy, and you're not going to do this. So she literally just jumps in the tube and starts, like, thinking that'll be your fast track back.
When that was happening, I'm like, why didn't she just send the backpack out? Like, it kind of bothered me, because I'm like, why did she have to go herself? They just basically needed those core memories.
Well,
it was, like, one way to make her happy, because it was linked to being happy.
Well, that's kind of, like, that is Joy's character, is because she needs to be in control so much that, like, she physically needs to go back up there so she can be at the helm again. Because
yeah, well, I'm saying, like, temporary solution. They could have just sent it, but then, you know, 3 seconds after that, it just doesn't work.
Yeah,
broke apart.
Yeah, the tube breaks or whatever, but I think that shows that, like, she, as much as the Riley is driven by emotion, Joy is a literal emotion, so she's also not thinking of, like, she's not thinking rationally, she's just like, this is my job is to keep this kid happy. They're not, they're messing up there, I need to go back up there and fix it myself, because she's very much a, like, I gotta do this job by myself, sure, they can come in every now and then, but she's head of the wheel, she's gotta be the one to make all the decisions.
Pretty much, and then they fall in a pit. And it's her and Bing Bong.
Yeah.
This is all alone.
Right. And yeah, I think, like, yeah, it's like, after Joy abandons her and it fails, Joy, or Sadness is just like, it's so obvious that I'm not needed, you clearly don't like me, she just kind of runs off crying and whatever, but, yeah, Joy and Bing Bong fall into the dump, basically, and it's just this pit of all the memories and all the items that have just been dumped in there. This is where we got real depressing.
Yeah, instantly he is just like, his hands going away, it's starting to fade, and I mean, like, that's an instant when he was in the dump.
Mm-hmm.
It wasn't just like a gradual from it.
No.
But they remembered that his little rocket ship to play with her is in the dump, and they sing because it's powered on music.
Mm-hmm.
And they're trying to get out of this dump, and it just keeps not working.
Yeah, like, Bing Bong's, like, telling her, it's like, look, once you're down here, you're stuck, and, like, Joy just...
Forgotten.
Yeah, you're forgot. You're erased from memory, and Joy's just, like, is not gonna take that standing down, and earlier in the movie, they went through, like, Riley's younger memories, and they showed, like, this this little wagon that they is supposed to be a rocket ship that she made when she was, like, 3, and it's powered by song, so they're like, we're gonna try to make a ramp to get back up out of the hole, and, yeah, this is the sad... Yeah.
Now, what? Aside from emotion and whatever,
mm-hmm.
did you get a, Toy Story 3 vibe from it, from, like, the dump? Because that's what kind of reminded me, just,
Not initially, but now that you say that, yeah, I kind of see that.
It reminded me of it without the fire, basically.
Right. But yeah, it's basically the same concept. But yeah, this part of the movie, I will not say I cried, but as I explained to you, Kyle, this is where I start getting a little verklempt.
Yeah.
It's just...
It was pretty sad.
It was sad. Yeah, because it's you see Joy is just, like, almost given up because she doesn't see a way out, and she's just like, she just wants to get back up there, and she's saying that basically Riley is gonna fall apart without her, and she just, like, breaks down in tears, and
like, Bing Bong's like, because they tried 2 times, he's
mm-hmm.
like, oh, I got a really good feeling about this one.
Yeah,
let's
they're
try it again.
Yeah, they're trying to use the rocket to get back up to the hill, and you can just see every time that Bing Bong is kind of piecing it together that he's too heavy, he's weighing the rocket down. So he's like, okay, I think if we do this one more time, we'll make it. And right as the rocket takes off, he jumps off.
Yeah.
It stays in the pit. And it's really kind of depressing the way he just, like, kind of accepts his, like, well, there's no way both of us are making it out of here. You're more important than I am. I'll stay here, and you watch him die, basically.
Yeah, he just fades away.
Yeah, he fades into
instantly.
He fades into dust, and it's kind of funny because while they're in the pit and they're trying to get out, you can gradually see him disappearing. Like, I think his arm disappears.
Yeah.
But yeah, you could just, like, as soon as you see that, you're like, he's not making it out of this, is he? And it was real depressing. Because the entire time they met, like, they were with him, Joy kept reassuring him, like, you know what, as soon as they get back, we're going to remind Riley of you, and you guys are going to have all those adventures you planned, and just as soon as they get to the pit, I'm like, oh, God, no.
That's kind of what pissed me off, but I'll get a little later into that.
Mm-hmm.
So, after that happened, they go back to Imagination Land,
mm-hmm.
and they're like... Because she's trying to catch Sadness
mm-hmm.
after she makes it out of the pit.
Yeah.
And then she makes, like, this really, really grand escape. It kind of bothered me, the whole ending for it. there was, like, this imaginary boyfriend generator, and she hit, like, 9,999.
Uh-huh.
And she uses this backpack, and even though she didn't catch all of them, uh-huh. she still had, like, a main, like, a good chunk of them. And it just bothered me, because I'm like, okay, she's got this backpack, it's full, like, it's got at least 100 people in there, maybe a little more, maybe a little less, whatever. Mm-hmm. I'm thinking to myself, like, they could have saved Bing Bong, they could have put him in this backpack, because there was so much stuff in there, and they showed it a little earlier on that Bing Bong had a bunch of these memories, and it's like, it kind of confuses you, because you're like, well, what the hell, why is he stealing all this shit? Well, it's because those were the memories of her with him.
Right.
He was taking all of them with him. But it bothered me because she had so much in this backpack where they could have saved him. But then again, I can see why they didn't because, I mean, like, she's 12. She has no use for him.
Yeah. I didn't think about that at the time because, you know, I was starting to get a little emotional at that point. And, like, I'm not, like, yes, this is very sad. But, yeah, now that you say that, it's like, yeah, that's kind of a big plot hole. They could have easily saved him.
Yeah.
For the structure of the movie, I saw why Bing Bong needed to die. I did too.
It's just they could have saved him.
He had a very symbolic death. Yeah, it was kind of interesting because I think at this point when she's trying to find sadness that Joy finally comes to like the realization of why sadness needs to be around. Because I think it was the core memory that sadness touched. She basically like
the one that she made, wasn't it?
No, because it was from Riley's childhood. It's when she like the hockey game, but yeah, Riley has this old memory of being lifted up after a hockey game by her teammates or whatever. But sadness touched that memory and made it sad. But what Joy finds out, because she basically swipes through it like you would like an iPhone or whatever, she like flips to earlier in the memory to find that Riley actually fucked up that game like hardcore, and
yeah.
it starts the memory out like right after she lost it. She's like sitting in a tree and her parents try to come up and console her, but then you see all of her teammates come over and try to cheer her up, and it's kind of like, I actually thought that was a really cool touch because it shows that you can't have joy without sadness, because it's like, if you're always happy, how are you going to know anything different? Because you need to have the opposite to balance it out. So you know, so you can feel one of them. You can't feel one without the other. And I thought that was a really cool way of saying, like, memories aren't just black and white, one thing. They're an amalgamation of different things. And they can mix and match various emotions to things.
Pretty much. After all that, they, like, I don't know, something with a bunch of imaginary boys, and
yeah, they're gonna make a bridge out of it or something.
Yeah, it's something with imaginary boys and a trampoline, and they miraculously get back to the tower after bouncing on it, and plexiglass so they can't get in.
I love this part of the movie because it just like it shows how the emotions know how to manipulate each other. Sadness and joy find a way to basically fly back to headquarters, but they're on the outside, so there's a window between them, and they're like, this glass, it's plexiglass, they can't just break it. So Disgust is like, wait a minute. So she starts like just throwing all these insults at Anger, and every time Anger gets like just balls to the wall mad, he's like, his head just ignites in flame. So she just, Disgust just keeps telling him how like how shitty of a job he's been doing, and just like it gets him so worked up and his head sets on fire. She just picks him up and uses him as a blowtorch to sear a hole in the mask. Window. Yeah, she pulls out a welder mask.
Yeah.
Don't know where she gets it from, but
and everybody was saying that she was the true hero of the movie. Disgust was the true hero.
No, I'll fully admit, Disgust is my favorite character. I thought she was sassy, and I like her.
So after that, she realizes that she's like, she doesn't want to run away. Sadness pulls out the light bulb, and then
yeah,
everything was fine. And, I mean, like, she stole her mom's
money. Yeah, dude, this, dude.
And nothing happened from that. My parents would kick my ass and throw me out.
Yeah.
As a kid. But yeah, there was no repercussion on that.
I don't, like, there may have been repercussion. They didn't show it to us, but, yeah, like, earlier in the movie, like, when Riley's plotting her way to get away, she's like, she goes online, finds a bus leaving. She's like, crap, I don't have any money. Goes downstairs, steals her mom's credit card in the, like, most how-did-you-not-get-caught moment. Because they're like, her mom's basically staring at her while she does it, and she's ugh. I don't know. But, yeah, like, Riley, she hops a bus, and she gets, like, a couple blocks before Joy and Sadness get back at the helm, and Sadness pulls out the light bulb, and she kind of realizes, like, why am I doing this? This is stupid. And runs back home and has this real heartfelt moment with her parents. She's just like, and this is the, I think this is the part of the moment, the movie, where, like, they want you to feel something, and god damn, they got me.
I feel nothing of that.
Well, because you're
sad with the,
cause
the death of an imaginary friend.
Because you're a heartless bitch.
my heart's pretty frozen.
I know. But yeah, Riley just, like, she breaks down to her parents. She's just like, I understand you guys are under a lot of pressure, but, like, and you want me to be happy, but, like, I just can't do this. I miss home. All this, I just can't deal with all this change. And you just, she's expecting, like, this explosion, and you just get this real nice moment where Riley and her parents are just hugging and crying and all this stuff. And it's where they, where I think Joy, like, it finally cements in her head how these dual emotion memories work, because at that moment, a new core memory is made, and it's both
sad and happy.
Yeah, it's golden blue, so it's two emotions. She's just like, how does that work? And this is like, yeah, Riley is super sad about this whole thing, but being consoled by her parents makes her happy, so it's like this memory has a dual layer to it.
I like that, because it looked like a marble. After it was done.
Yeah, that was,
they were all, like, basically marbles.
Yeah, that's cool. But yeah, then basically the movie wraps up. Riley goes and joins a new hockey team in the new town and all that stuff. And, okay, now, go ahead.
One thing that I really liked, and I'm sure this is what you're going to get into,
probably,
is they started showing emotions in other people's
yeah.
at the end. And what I thought was really interesting was that Riley, Joy was her main, like, Joy was her head,
mm-hmm.
but when you look into her parents,
yeah,
it's kind of fucked up.
Yeah.
Sadness is the main in the mom's head. Sadness is the main, and anger is the dad's main.
Right, you see who's really at everyone else's control, and it's like, that's kind of sad when you think about it.
Yeah.
It's like, jeez.
She keeps thinking of cheating on her husband and all this stuff, and it's like, holy crap. But then, like, you look at everybody else in the pretty much credits, and everybody has, like, a different main, which I thought
yeah.
was cool.
Yeah, it's, yeah.
They're all done by, like, different voice actors, too, which I thought was cool. It wasn't, yeah. like, them trying to do a different voice.
Right, yeah, it's cool that, like, all the emotions have the same basic design, but, like, how they change depending on which character they're in. Well, I think there's, like, this goth girl, so all the emotions are goth. The mom is, like, really floral, and the dad's emotions are all in suits.
Yeah.
No, but, like, it's the dumbest joke, but is the hardest I laughed in this entire movie. It's, like, the last 2 minutes where Riley's about to go onto the rink for a game, and she runs into this other boy her age, and she's like, oh, whatever. But then it zooms into the boy's head, and all the emotions just freaking out, just going, like, girl, girl.
Yeah, that reminds me of the SpongeBob thing, where it's just fire.
Everything's on fire, and they just don't know how to handle it. It's like, oh, God, that is, oh. It's like, it's such an obvious joke, but my God, that little way they executed it, that was hilarious.
I thought the joke with the gum thing was kind of funny at the end. The first couple times with the gum thing, because it was like, oh yeah, we just send it to headquarters to screw with them.
Oh yeah, they sometimes during the where Joy and Sadness are putting through the brain, they run across these workers who work down in the library or whatever, and they have this one random memory. It's a gum commercial jingle, and they say they just send it up to headquarters and it'll autoplay for them, and it's just to fuck with them sometimes.
Yeah. And it was like, it was funny the first two times. They like overuse that.
Yeah. I've got a rule that you never do a joke more than three times.
That's a real thing, though. It's the comedy rule of three.
Right. And that's it's a good thing. It's like, you can do the first two times, like, in pretty close succession, give it a little bit, let it rest a little bit, and bring it back one more time, you can hit the punch. But yeah, I think they kind of it was funny the first couple times, but, you know, it kind of, yeah.
It showed I think it was like a bus driver or something, all of his was anger, but there were different colors. I thought that was kind of funny, too.
Yeah.
But that's when they overused the gum thing.
Yeah.
It was another joke.
I thought it was funny that, like, when the credits roll, they start popping through the side characters of the movie, what's going on in their head. And then they just jump into a dog and a cat's brain. And it was, yeah. I just thought it was funny.
It was funny to see that fear was, like, the main in Cats.
Did the cat have a mane? Because, like the dog, I don't remember who if there was any head of the dog, but, like, the dogs were basically all just, like, yeah, but it was just funny because, like, this man's walking down the street with a piece of pizza, and the dog's in the brain just like, the man has food, get the man. And they just start chasing him, and then it zooms in on this cat in the background, and none of the cats are, like, at the helm or anything. They're just kind of wandering around doing cat stuff.
Yeah.
And then I think, like, the fear cat just jumps up on the keyboard, accidentally presses something, and he freaks out, and they all start freaking out, and then this cat, it zooms back out, and the cat just jumps for no reason and runs away.
Yeah. I thought that was funny, because cats are pretty much fear-based.
Well, I thought it was just funny, because, like, it just shows how random cats can be. Like, I'm looking at my own cat right now, just rolling around on the floor if no one paying attention to him, but, yeah, he'll get up and start running around in circles for no reason. I mean, I'm sure he has a reason, but...
So the other plot hole I found in the movie, mm-hmm. and I don't know if it was just something stupid or what, when they do the whole gum joke, all they do is they take the marble and they push it backwards, and it goes and gets sent to headquarters.
Yeah.
And that's all they needed to do to send it. And I'm like, well, the core memories is the whole reason this is going on. And that's why I was like, why doesn't she just send the core memories? Because that's what's keeping those islands alive, mm-hmm. basically.
Huh. Yeah, I guess that would work. And it's also kind of weird how do the tubes work in reverse, exactly?
So they were able to send this gum jingle to her. It was, like, absolutely no problem. But that was the whole reason of the movie. These core memories are what's keeping the islands together, and they're breaking down because they don't have them. There's mm-hmm. nothing powering them. So that's what bothered me is that, you know, a temporary solution, yeah, they're going to get back home, but she could have temporarily sent those back up to keep that shit alive. That's what I kind of figured.
Yeah. I mean, from the outside, that makes sense, but, you know, like I was saying, Joy is not trying to think long term. She's wanting to... She has to be the one that returns them. She can't just send it up there and have the other ones do it for her. Because basically you can see that she doesn't trust the other ones to do their job. She's like, she has to be there. She has to be in control. Or else, as you can kind of see, the other emotions kind of just mess things up.
Yeah. I was just thinking, like, all these things are falling apart, and the only way that they kept saying, the only way to get back there was that little thin wire.
Mm-hmm.
And in order to keep that stable would be to get the core memories.
Like, yeah.
That's how I saw it.
Yeah.
Other thing, I mean, I liked the movie. It was okay. I liked it better than Brave, of course. I liked it better than some other Pixar movies. If I had to give a grade on it, though, it would be like a B+. Like, it was alright. It wasn't the best Pixar's done. It was okay. I liked the characters.
Mm-hmm.
The designs were cool. It was pretty neat for, like, experiment with the particles and stuff that they were doing. The characters, I don't know, I felt the girl was a little hollow, even though the emotions were the main point.
Yeah.
I just felt there wasn't, like, too much to...
Yeah, I agree. I think Riley was a little bland, but I agree. I think it kind of makes sense for her because she's not really the focus. She's, yeah. It's kind of how I've always thought of, like, the human body. It's just, like, we're kind of just, like, ourselves are the brain, and it's just the brain driving a meat robot.
Yeah. So, what did you think about it?
I kind of disagree with you. I'm not, like, I actually thought this was really good. I would go as far as to say, I would put this in Pixar's top five. I don't know, this, I was kind of worried with Pixar taking so much time off in between this and Monsters University, which I really like Monsters University. It's not top five, but I really liked it. But, yeah, I thought this was a really cool concept. The character, the whole world design was really cool. The way they can show how just the characters themselves are just really deep, and like how these emotions, while they do represent that emotion, they're also layered themselves and not bound to just like Joy's gonna be happy all the time, sad's gonna be sad all the time. They can branch out a little bit. Yeah, I thought this was really ambitious for them, and I think they pulled it off really well. I definitely want to see this again. I think when my girlfriend gets back, we're gonna go see this again because she didn't get to see it with me. I feel like there might have been some little bits and pieces that I missed. I thought it was really cool how they conveyed all these different kind of thought structures and like how the human brain works, but it didn't seem like it was pandering to you. Like, it's not like saying, it's not a psychology lecture where it's like, this is what this is and this is how it works. And it's like, it kind of comically walked you through it in a way that made sense to the plot. I would definitely, if you're a fan of Pixar, if this is a sign of anything, it's a sign that Pixar is getting back on the right track, because the last couple years, basically,
pretty hard on them.
Yeah, it's not been bad. Brave was okay. Cars 2 was terrible. And Monsters University was okay. It was a little, you know, predictable, but Inside Out, I think, was a really cool original idea for them. It makes me excited for Good Dinosaur later this year, because they're getting two movies out this year kind of to make up for the absence. But I can only hope that the next one's going to be as good as this one.
Now, on the flip side of that,
mm-hmm.
I took my girlfriend to see it. She absolutely did not like this movie.
Oh?
Like, 0% hated it.
0 stars on Yelp?
Yeah, 0 stars on Yelp. I can kind of see where she's coming from.
Mm-hmm.
From what she explained to me.
Yeah.
She said she felt like the story wasn't there. She said she felt like it could have done with a better story. She said that she felt like it was an animated short stretched out, like based on plot, whatever. She feels like it was like super padded. It should have been like a animated short. I don't know. That's how she felt.
Hmm. Well, I can kind of agree with her on some level, in the sense that like there were a lot of parts in this movie where they would go from one area from the net to the next. Like they go to the dream place, they go to the imagination place. And it just seems like they're about, okay, we're going to get back now. And I'm like, the movie can't be this short. And then they go to another thing. And it seemed like, I can see where she would think that's padding. But to me, I think that the ideas they would come up with to keep the journey going was interesting enough to, at least to keep my attention.
Yeah.
Hey, I am never one to say someone is wrong for an opinion. If you didn't like the movie, then hey, it's not for you. I'm with that with a lot of things. I'll never say I hate something. It's just not for me. I like this movie. I think it was really well done.
I'll be honest. I'll say if I hated something or not.
I know you will.
I didn't hate this.
Well, good. Oh, jeez. Well, like I said, good movie, art style's cool. I think Pixar is on the right track again. So,
4 stars on Yelp. Yes.
Does Yelp have, is 4 stars the maximum?
I think it's 5.
I have no idea. I don't go on Yelp.
I don't either. Fuck Yelp.
anyway, Kyle, do you have any parting words to end this out? No?
No, I think I covered it.
Okay, cool. All right, well, I guess that wraps up our first ever review on this show. There will hopefully be more in the future.
And hopefully we'll do it better.
I thought we did pretty well. We went over the plot. We said what we liked about it. You gave a grade. I did not, because scales are dumb. But, whatever. So, if you like this episode, please share this with whoever. There's links in the descriptions to, I forgot to mention this on the last episode. I finally got iTunes to work, so we are on iTunes. If you want to download this podcast to go instead of listening to it on YouTube. So, go check that out, subscribe, leave reviews and stuff, share this. Yeah, there's links in the description to all of our various social media sites. We're on Facebook and Twitter and Tumblr if you want to follow us on there. There's links to me and Kyle's personal pages if you'd like to follow us personally.
And, yeah. Like, feel free to even tell us what you thought of it.
Yeah. Yeah, Kyle and I are still, you know, it's still early. We're still trying to figure out what this show is going to be exactly. So it would be a real big help if you all left us some comments about, like, what's working for you, what's not, maybe an idea you have for a future show or something we should talk about or a segment. Or just anything, any idea you have for the show, or anything you have to say. Try not to be too mean. I'm sensitive.
Ooh, okay. So I think that wraps it up.
I think that wraps it up for the Ink and Paint Club podcast this week. Thank you again for listening. We'll be back next week with something.
Determined.
To be determined, probably at the last second again.
Yes.
Like we do. All right. Thanks for listening, everybody. We'll see you next week.
Thanks for listening. I love you guys.
Kyle, we need to get a restraining order for you. Quit saying you love people. It's unwarranted.